To everybody, yes. Good morning, hallelujah, 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 all the time, God is good, come on, say that God is good, hallelujah, thank you Jesus, hallelujah, we thank you God for your sweet presence that's in this place, we want you to have your way in this place as we bless you Lord God, we want you to accept our worship, Lord God, as a sweet aroma to your nostrils. We thank you, God. We love them. How many love them? Y'all love them? Hallelujah. 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 Listen, we're about to just get into it because I can't bless the Spirit of the Lord is just flowing in this place. Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah.
Every word of worship, one of
praise,
every praise, every praise is to our God.
Hallelujah,
hallelujah,
our God,
to our God,
hallelujah,
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 is to our God,
every praise,
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. God is amazing. Amen.
She is.
I said, God is amazing. Amen. My wife said she had to be up there by herself. And I said, no, you won't. I said, there's no way possible. I will praise my God in secret. I'm a public praiser. I don't have any public praises in this place. There's not anybody in the praise to praise the King. I said, I got your back, girl. I said, I got your back. I said, I got your back, my honey, because she's always had my back. I got her back. I got it back on. Ask me how I sound. Just don't put it on the disc.
Amen. That's right.
Don't drop it to the publisher. Not yet. I wasn't ready for this when my vocals wasn't loosened. Come on, somebody.
Hallelujah.
If it was loosened, I would have set you free. But
my God. Hallelujah.
Come on here, somebody. But it wasn't loose yet. I wasn't ready yet. My God. My Lord. But I'm excited to be in the house of the Lord.
Yeah.
And I'm excited to be able to call Jesus my King.
Oh, yeah.
Anybody excited to know that Jesus is your King? I'm excited to know that He's my King and that He's my Lord and that He still is on the throne.
Yes.
That He's still sitting there. He's still looking out for us. And I'm excited about the word that He's given us on this morning. Anybody was blessed by last week's word?
Amen. Amen.
Talking about economy interruptions.
My God.
Economy interruptions. I think it's befitting for the place we're in right now.
Yeah.
Economy interruptions, a summer series that He has me teaching. I thank God for the grace that He's given me to be able to teach His word. But how many of you know, if you don't apply it, it means nothing to you?
Amen. Amen.
Come on, somebody.
Amen.
Hearing the word only does nothing. The Bible says that you must be doers.
That's right.
Somebody say doers.
Doers.
Say it like you want to say doers.
Doers.
Say I'm a doer.
I'm a doer.
You got to be a doer of this holy word. You got to apply that which He said in order for you to see what He has in store for you. Faith that is not mixed with work is there. It got to be mixed with something. It got to be mixed with something. It got to be mixed with something. I may not can cook as good as my wife, but one thing I can get down on, if you give me some beans.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah.
If you give me some beef, if you give me some ground beef,
that's it.
And you give me some season that I need, I can't tell you.
Well, which one's on it? Which one's on it?
I need. I let my secrets out. But some of it, I need certain seasons. If you give me some ground beef and some beans, I'll tell you, I'll put those two together.
Yes, you will. Yes, you will.
And you'll get a sweet smell and aroma. Until I got to, you get something that you ain't never tasted before. I said, I know. But I'm trying to tell you, don't play me short. But what I'm trying to bring forth, it doesn't really come into fruition until I'm able to mix all the things together. It don't really taste the same way unless you mix it together. And you don't have the full impact unless you mix it together. All I'm saying is, I'm glad that you had a hearing word. And I wish you would apply it with your faith that it can be mixed together. You can work that thing. Somebody say, work that thing.
Work that thing.
You gotta work that thing if you want to see the results of that thing. I'm excited this morning. I'm excited. Not just because I'm getting the word, but because I know when I leave out of here, I know the enemy's gonna bring something for me to mix my faith with.
Doesn't he?
Do I got anybody that's giving any kind of attacks? And they're like, anybody know anything about a fight? Anybody know anything about a struggle? Anybody know anything about a battle? Anybody know anything about having to come against some persecution and some things, but that you understand that you have enough word in you.
Yes,
that when it comes against the forces that comes against you, your faith can be applied.
Mm. That's it.
Your faith is only as strong as the fight it encounters.
That's it.
that your enemy don't waste equipment on somebody who can't fight.
Mm-hmm.
I learned it a long time ago that your enemy don't waste equipment on people who can't fight.
Right.
When you can fight, they gotta go find something. A brick, a pole, a stick, a branch, a heel, a bat, or something. Why? Right, because you're getting the best of me. I just want somebody to know I'll feel the win. I think I got my help coming. coming in the room. I need somebody to know that the reason why I hit you so hard is because you get the best of them. Y'all hear what I'm saying? It's because you get the best of your enemies. You on the top. I know you may feel like you on the bottom, but baby, you on the top. You are on the top of this thing, and you don't get your heart because you're getting the best of them. God, Jesus. Somebody said that thing. I'm getting the best of them. Oh, God, Jesus. Even if you don't feel it, you better proclaim it. By faith, you better declare it. By faith, you better announce it. By faith, I'm getting the best.
Yes.
Yeah, I feel it.
Yes, Lord.
I'm excited.
Oh,
I'm excited. Am I the only one about excited for God this morning? Am I the only one excited for God this morning? Come on, I don't care where you are. You got to be excited for what God is doing. Because if you can watch me, that means He blessed you. If you got something to watch me, that means He blessed you. If you got something, a phone, a computer, a device, if you want the power of the TV screen, and you can watch it, that means He has blessed you.
Thank you, Lord. That's it. Yes.
I learned a long time ago.
All facts.
That if you don't do anything else,
yes.
Come on, somebody.
Yes.
That was youngsters, but that was Mr. Pachimo. If you don't do anything else,
yes.
He's already done enough.
Yes.
He's already done enough.
Yes.
God, that's him already done enough.
Yes.
He's already done enough.
Yes.
He's already done enough. I'm going to throw in my head. Can I throw in my head?
Yes, Lord.
Can I throw in my head? If you have your Bibles, go with me to the book of Genesis. I want to go to part two of this thing. Part two of the series that we started last week talking about economy interruptions. And I'm going to derive my conversation with you. That's all we're having.
Mm-hmm.
We're having a conversation. I'm going to derive my conversation with you from the book of Genesis.
Uh-huh.
Genesis chapter number 15.
Yeah.
See, the reason I love the word of God so much, minister, is because it's like a never-ending conversation with God. The conversation never concludes. It just starts in another place, in another paradigm, in another dimension. It just picks up sometimes where you left off. It's a conversation that never ends. God, I love a God who knows how to speak exactly what I need when I need it.
Yes, Lord.
Come on, somebody. Genesis chapter number 15. Genesis chapter number 15. When you have it, rest on your feet. Stand to your feet.
Yes.
I say rest on it because I hope you got some good house shoes on this morning.
My God.
Hope you got any your good flip flops. Praise the Lord.
Yeah.
Your good Crocs this morning. The good ones. The good ones. The good ones. The socks. Some of y'all say we just got on socks, Reverend. Well, that's okay.
Yeah.
Long as it's comfortable to thy anointed feet. Praise the Lord.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Genesis chapter number 15.
Mm-hmm.
Genesis chapter number 15. I won't get into much of the theological premise behind the text in terms of calling out some of the things that this represents, because it represents a lot of different things. This is actually the first time when you see in your Bible where God says, I am. This is the first time when He makes his conversation with man personal.
Come on now. Come on now.
That is not just prophetic, but it's personal.
I like that.
Oh, God. It's the first time where we see Him making Himself a typology, meaning a type of a thing to someone, to Abram, who He's talking to. You'll see what I mean in the text when He says, I am the shield. He's given an intermediate, or how about this? He's giving some intimacy with Abram that he's never had before.
Okay. Amen.
Have you ever had intimacy with God?
Yeah.
Oh, God.
Yeah.
Yes.
I know you may have had intimacy with man.
Yeah.
But I promise you, if you experience intimacy with God,
yes.
There's nothing like experiencing intimacy with God.
Yes, Lord.
That's it right there.
That He shows Himself to be something that you've never seen before. Oh,
yes.
God.
Yes,
come on, somebody.
Yes. I love Him.
Oh, God. Your emotions is going crazy. You don't know whether to shout or to cry or to scream or to run. You don't know what to do.
By going every which way. That's it.
This is Him showing Himself in an intimate manner with Abram that He's never shown before.
Uh-huh.
By this point, I've been talking. If you can't find Genesis 15, we're going to pray for you.
It's all right.
Beginning at verse number one, it says, after these things, somebody say, after these things.
After these things.
It's key that you understand that this came after something. The word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision, saying, do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield, your exceedingly great reward. My God. He says, I'm not just your reward. I exceed the greatest reward you got.
Oh, my Lord.
Whatever rewards you got, I exceed that. I wish I know the type of rewards Abram had at this point. God says, I exceed all of that.
Lord,
but Abram said, Lord God, what will you give me, seeing I go childless or seedless? And the heir of my house is Elijah of Damascus, my servant.
Right.
Then Abram said, look, you have given me no offspring, no seed. Mm-hmm. Indeed, one is born in my house is my heir. He's talking about his servant. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him saying, this one shall not be your heir, but one who will come from your own body shall be your heir. Oh God.
Yes, Lord.
Oh Jesus. Then he brought him outside. Take a walk with me. And said, look now toward heaven and count the stars, if you are able to number them. Tell him if you can.
Yeah.
And he said to him, so shall your descendants be. Last verse. And he believed in the Lord.
Yeah.
And he believed in the Lord. And he accounted it to him for righteousness. I'm going to read James chapter number 2. I didn't plan on doing this, but I want to read it just for your context, just so you can understand the synergy between this Old Testament story that we just read and where we are in the New Testament.
Yes, Lord.
I want to read this. James chapter 2, verse number 22. Mm-hmm. It says, do you see that faith was working together with works? And by works, faith was made perfect. 23 says, and the scripture fulfilled, which says, watch this, Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him as righteousness. We just saw that, right?
Amen.
But watch what James says next. Can I read this to you? James says, and he called him the friend of God.
Wait, Jay. I didn't see that in the original text. I didn't see that in the dialogue between Abram and God.
Right.
I didn't see God say, you are my buddy, my friend, my compadre. I didn't see that in the original text. I just saw him say that he believed God and accounted to him as righteousness. But James said, there's another revelation to this that God gave me some insight into, in which he gave Isaiah, in which he also gave in 2 Chronicles, where both of those state that after God said this, that he said, you are now my friend.
Yeah.
Which tells me, Sister Tamika, that sometimes we're in a situation that we don't know just how favored we are until we get out of it. Y'all don't know what I'm talking about.
That's
this
right.
Sometimes we really don't know how blessed we are until we look.
That's right.
Back at it. Oh, God, I wish I had a church in there. You have to look back at some things. They said, God, if it wasn't for you on my side, what would I do? I didn't know you favored me that much. I didn't know that so many people died due to this situation. I didn't know that this many people got sick. I didn't know that this many people lost their job. But I was the same. You kept me. You shielded me. You protected me. I didn't know I was your friend when I was sinning. But now that I look back at it, oh God, I feel my help. I feel my help. Oh God. But when I look back at somebody, say, look back at it. Look back at it. Oh, Jesus. Sometimes it requires us to look back at it just to see how faithful you were. Oh, God.
Yes, Lord.
Well, I'm trying my best. I'm trying my best. I've been holding this in for a while. We're going to get through this today.
Yes.
I want to speak.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. should have been us. Woo! Hallelujah.
Yeah, Lord. Woo!
Yeah, Lord. Yeah, Lord. Yeah, Lord. We could have been there, Pastor. Yeah. We could have been there, Pastor. Woo! Yeah. It should have been us. Woo! Yeah. Hallelujah. Yes, come on, Pastor. Yes. Hallelujah.
Thank you.
Hallelujah.
Oh, God.
Oh, God.
Thank you.
Come on,
Jesus.
Hallelujah.
For a subtopic, I want to minister from the topic. When it doesn't add up.
Mm.
My God. When it doesn't add up.
Right.
He said, count the stars if you can.
Yeah. Faith. Thank you, God.
And then he said, he believed him. And God says, I'm a count what you can't see.
Uh-huh. Come on now.
Even though you couldn't count what you could see as righteousness.
Yes, Lord.
Sometimes it just doesn't add up.
Yes, Lord.
Just for a moment.
Yeah.
Just for a moment.
Yeah, thank you, Lord.
When it doesn't add up, you may be seated in the presence of the king. This part in the story, what we deal with Abram, who has not received his full name into Abraham, in which then will be turned in a couple chapters later, in chapter number 17, where God will say your name is no longer Abram, but it is Abraham, where he will cease to be called what is known as the exalted father. That's what Abraham means, the father of the multitude of many nations. That means God will stop making him exalted going this way, and God will start opening up revelation going that way. He will start to deal with the offspring of Abraham, where now he's dealing with the man of Abram.
Yes, Lord.
Why? Because he has to build you up in order for you to have the capacity that he wants to walk in.
Come on now.
It's not just about taking you somewhere that you're not ready to walk into. It's about building you up to the face of your character that you can have the capacity he has in store for you. Shelby, there's no blessing that shall overtake your character when you have enough capacity that will cause you to run away from God. If your character is not there long enough to sustain the blessing you get, then you will forget the giver and you will start to worship the gift.
Yes, Lord.
So he initially deals with Abel, who means exalted father, and then he goes to call his name Abraham, multitude of many nations. But even him being called Abram is a contradiction, because being a father with no children is tough to swallow.
Yes, it is.
How can you call me exalted father and I have no children?
Come on now.
How can you call me the father who is high, the father who is exalted, but the father who goes into exaltation, but I have no offspring?
Don't add up.
It just don't add up. You call me the father, but my circumstances is not a reflection of the call. Can I let somebody in on a little secret? Sometimes God will call you what your circumstance doesn't define that you really are.
Woo!
Sometimes God will call you before the experiences catch up with you. Sometimes he'll call you before you even know who your identity really is. Sometimes you'll be called father before you ever have a child. Sometimes you'll be called husband before you say I do. Sometimes you'll be called wife before you walk down the aisle. Sometimes you'll be called business owner before you ever sign the EIN. Y'all don't know what I'm talking about. Sometimes God will call you that conflicts with your situation.
Come on now. Amen.
Yes, Lord. Because oftentimes the calling conflicts with the circumstances.
Uh-huh.
He's called Abraham, but he has no children. We see this in the text. He says, you call me Abraham, but you don't give me a child. And I couldn't help but really consider how conflicted Abraham really was and himself. Because the text starts off by saying, after these things, the word of the Lord came to him in a vision. After these things. And I had to go back and see what these things were. These things in just the preceding chapter number 14, he had just fought a fight with five kings to go back and get his nephew Lot that they took enslaved. He had to fight through, he had to gain a victory in order to recapture his nephew Lot and the people of Sodom and Gomorrah and amongst many other nations at that time. He had to go back and he had to stand up against five different kings that they could not defeat. But he had 318 men who
who he trained in his own house to go back and get victory where they couldn't get victory. And I had to pause for a moment because God spoke a word in my belly at that time that I want to share with you. He said, new vision doesn't come unless you have new victory.
Wow. Come on now. Okay.
New vision doesn't come unless you have new victory.
Okay.
I won't give you a new vision when you don't have a new victory. Why? Because new vision always precedes new victory. If you're still fighting the same fight, you don't need to see nothing different.
Right.
God ain't talking to me.
Right.
You don't need to see nothing different if you're always fighting the same battle. You're in the same struggle. Yeah. You're in the same struggle. You might as well stop asking for vision until you conquer the thing that you're battling. Why? Because once you get a new victory, then you won't get a new vision. So we must ask for vision before the victory.
That makes sense.
So we must ask to be on the throne before we defeat our Goliath.
That's right.
Oh, y'all are talking to me this morning.
Yes, Lord.
See, when Abraham initially was called, he was called back in Genesis chapter 12 when he was amongst his people. He was in his own land in Ur of the Chaldeans. Chaldeans is also what we know as the Babylonians. And we know what happened in that story. But that's where he's from originally. He's from Ur. And he's called out of that place to go to another place that's not familiar with the place he's in. So another place that God says, I'll make your name great, which is kind of a pun on God. I love God. God, you know, I can't get it. If I get to this, I'll stay here. But my God, he's so wise in his words, Brother Richard, because when he speaks something, it's just not just to say it. He always has an intent behind what he says. And for you to really understand the God you serve, you got to know his heart.
Yeah.
Because in chapter 11, that's when they start building the Tower of Babel.
Mm.
And the reason they built the Tower of Babel is because they wanted to make their own name great. They said, we will become a great nation. Our name will be great. So let's build a tower up to heaven. And God had to come out to confuse the language. You remember that? And then he came to Abraham, and he made Abraham into a new progenitor, what's called a progenitor, a new a race, a whole new race of himself. And then in the blessing to me, he says, now I'm going to make your name great. Which means that the people who try to do it themselves can't do it. Mm. Unless I make your name great, your name will never be great.
He said,
you don't have to cry when people start calling you other names. Why? Because they don't really know their name anyway.
My God.
I don't know who I'm talking to. Sometimes people will call you stuff because they don't know who you really are. They don't know who you really are. They knew who you really were. Then they must stop trying to make their own name great.
That's
all happy by myself. So he told Abraham, he said, I'll make your name great, and I'll make you the blessing. Well, when people bless you, they'll be blessed. And when they curse you, they'll be cursed. That's the first thing he gave. And he gave that to Abraham while he was in his own country. In a familiar territory, faith is always easy to say yes to when everything is familiar.
Yeah, okay. Come on now.
Oh, God. It's easy to say yes to faith when everything is familiar. When everything is familiar, it is about 11 years ago, me and my family, we moved here to Texas. And before that, we were living in Mississippi. And in Mississippi, we knew everywhere to go. Like, we've been living there for 10 years. We went to college there. We had our first couple children there. And we lived there for the entire duration of our young adulthood. So we knew how to get to certain places. I'm going to tell you what those things were. But we knew how to get to just about anywhere you wanted to go. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. We knew how to get around. But when we moved to Texas, as soon as we moved here, although we visited here a few times, we needed a GPS to get around.
Yes, Lord.
We had to put in the destination. We had to put in where we were going. We had to put in where we were. We had to know at least 2 points in the GPS. We had to know where we were and where we were going. And from that point, the GPS would take us to different places wherever we needed to be. And we had to do that for a while. Why did we have to do that for a while? Because this place wasn't familiar to us. So when a place is not familiar, you need somebody to give you directions, maybe a new voice to give you directions because you've never been there before.
Oh God,
most of us have faith that's inactive because we will never get out of the familiar. So we may not forget what God's voice sounds like. Why? Because we know everything to do. On Sunday, I'm going to go here. On Monday, I'm going to go here. On Tuesday, I'm going to do this. On Wednesday, I'm going to cook chicken. On Thursday, I'm going to be tacos. On Friday, we're going to be big burrito. And on Saturday, we're going to sit there and watch a movie. And Sunday, we're going to do it all over again. And God is saying, I'm trying to call you out of your familiar. Why? Because I need you to hear my voice again. I need you to rescue in these places. I need to take you on a new journey. That's what marriage is, baby. I know people get frustrated when you say I do, but if you step into a new territory, well, God is trying to give you his voice in a different way, and you are not in familiar territory, don't fret not. Why? Because it's not because God has left you. He's just redirecting you and places you've never been before. think is good, we can say yes. Abram, he said, yes, I'll follow you. Wasn't even his God. Wasn't even the God of the Chaldeans. But he heard the voice of the true and living God. And he said, yes. And when he starts the journey, the plan God gave him didn't match the path. Ooh. Ooh. Have you ever trusted God?
Come on now.
In his plan.
Uh-huh.
But when you start walking,
ooh,
the path didn't look like the plan he told you.
Come on now.
God, I wish I had somebody to do. I wish I had a church. There's not, if you ain't saying that you're lying, there's not a person in this place that can say that they trusted God on the path.
Yeah.
According to his plan.
Yeah.
And the path looked like the plan that he told you at the beginning.
Yes, Lord.
There is a point in your walk with God where the path will conflict with the plan.
Yeah.
And the path becomes so excruciatingly painful, you begin to question whether or not the plan is what he really said. God gave everybody to tell you the truth. Is this really the plan?
Yeah.
Because the plan is not in symmetry according to the plan.
This ain't the way.
Someday, Monica, this ain't the way I signed up for. This ain't the one I said yes to.
Yeah.
I'm looking like what me and you agreed on back here, such and such. When you told me that I will be prosperous and successful. When you told me that my kids will be blessed. When you told me that we will have our own business. Well, I thought that by the age of 30, I have my whole house. About 35, I have my new car. About 40, I'll be doing this. About 45, I'll be doing that. About 60, I have my own retirement. I'll be good. And you're saying that the path that I'm going is not something like a plan. You get me? But I need to tell somebody, don't get afraid. Why? Because the promise is always greater than the past. The promise is always greater than the past. He may have to take you to the present before you get to the promise, but the promise is still the promise. Don't quit in the present. Why? Because the past is not as good. The promise is always greater.
Yeah.
That's it. That's your God.
Sometimes he has to take you through prison to get you to palace.
Amen.
Even though palace was the plan.
Yeah.
Sometimes the path deviates from what we had in mind. But God says, I haven't changed the plan. Somebody say, he hasn't changed the plan.
He hasn't changed the plan.
He has not changed the plan. The plan is still the same. And when Abram leaves Ur, he goes to Haran, him and his father, Terah, and then Haran, and his father ends up dying, and he's supposed to be in Canaan by this point. He then therefore goes to Canaan thereafter. Many believe that the Amorites settled in Canaan while Abram was in Haran because he took somebody with him that shouldn't have been there. So he took his journey too long before he was ever supposed to accomplish it, because God said, leave your household and your kindred and your family back here, and he didn't leave his family. He tried to take his family on a journey they couldn't afford.
Yeah. Yeah, Lord.
Sometimes we try to take people with us.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. My God.
We try to take people into our future that we're supposed to left in our past. Sometimes.
Lord,
my God.
My God.
My God. Sometimes we try to pull people along with us who don't have enough to conquer the journey, and they will make us stop before we reach our destination. Watch me now. And if we're not careful, we'll settle. And we'll make settling succeeding when the truth of the matter is we're supposed to be farther alone. But because we got to stop with you, we'll just settle here and say we're successful because I left there. See, I'm going to a new level. This ain't the level where we get happy just because you left.
This ain't
the level that you praise on just because you obeyed the initial voice. No.
Yeah.
God said, I gave you a destiny, baby. I gave you a step of action. I gave you a step into a purpose. If you ain't accomplished that, you ain't finished yet. If you ain't hit that road, you ain't stuck yet. You ain't dead yet. You ain't made it. Don't stop, become settled in the place you are. Why? Because success is not at the point in which you settle.
Yes, Lord.
Some people are settling with the ultimate God first thing.
Yeah.
And they say, I'm happy just to be married. The devil is alive. Y'all ain't talking to me. Some people are settling with their bank account being $100.
Yeah.
And God said, I told you that it'd be a million. You gotta stop settling. You ain't selling for people who can't even talk four sentences to you. And you say, well, I don't think there's no other man out there. Baby, the man is out there.
Lord. You just got to stop saying it.
Yes, Lord. Come on. Come on. Yes. You speak it.
Come on.
Yes.
Go ahead. You're talking right, yes, Lord.
He settled too long in Haran, then he ends up going to Canaan, where now he's in Canaan and a famine comes. Economy interruption.
I got it.
An economy interruption happens that pushes him to Egypt. He leaves Canaan and goes to Egypt. And right at the brink of Egypt, he's going to walk into Egypt. He said, hey, babe. Hey, come to Sarah. He said, oh, Sarai at the time. He said, yeah. Look, check this out. Mm-hmm. I know these jokers.
Yep.
That's in the Bible, just in the other version. He said, I know these jokers. If you say you my wife, they're going to try to kill me.
Yeah.
Go and say you my sister. Technically,
right,
you are my half sister,
right,
which she really is. We just gonna take the half out,
yeah, Lord,
and say you my sister.
Yeah, yeah.
And they go to Egypt, and Sarah says that their sister and brother. And the Bible says that the Pharaoh favored Abram in Egypt, and that's where he begins to accumulate his wealth.
Yeah.
They start giving him sheep.
Yeah.
He start eating grapes and stuff, man. Because they favored the man. He got his toes twiggling in the sun.
Oh,
he got his suntan lotion on. He good. He getting a good tan. They're over there feeding him grapes, and he says, "Oh, boom, y'all." He's over there talking. He's just He getting that good stuff. He getting that, giving that caviar. He can't even say it right. He over here eating good and eating until God sends a plague to Pharaoh. Why? Because God says that's really his wife. That ain't his sister. And Pharaoh gets upset. And I have to pause for a moment because the Bible never says anything about Sarah. And typically when I teach this, I always talk about Abram lying. But I have to pause for a moment because I need to talk about the silence of a spouse.
Oh my God.
Because sometimes,
my God,
our spouses who know what the truth really is should speak up.
Mm.
Would in turn not lean towards God,
yeah,
but will lean towards man,
yeah,
even if it doesn't benefit them in the long run.
Come on now.
Oh, can I make this thing plain? See, the text is talking about how Abram is favored, but it never talks about what Sarah had to deal with.
Come on now.
Yeah. Abram said, baby, this is for us.
Yeah.
But the truth of the matter is, it's really for him. It really wasn't for us.
Oh.
And sometimes you have to be able to speak the truth. Because the Bible says, speak the truth in love. And my book is a real book, Ephesians 4:15. If you don't know that verse, it's Ephesians 4:15, where the Bible says, speak the truth in love. And watch this. It says, and for you to grow up in all things, which means lying is a conception of your immaturity. Mm-hmm. Lying is truly identifying how immature you really are. When you can't speak up the truth in love, it's identifying how immature you really are. I want to get back to the relationship part. Why? Because I believe that while Abram was over here kicking it, Sarah is in the house with multiple women, because in Pharaoh's house, you are never just one woman. You are amongst the ones he can pick from, and no woman that I know wants to compete with another woman.
Come on now.
Jesus. Oh God. And sometimes our spouses who don't speak the truth will allow our other spouse to go off astray when you know it's the wrong route. And you know, oh, I know it's quiet, but somebody say, ouch. My single people just get this about prophetic utterance if you don't know what I'm talking about. But my married people, you know exactly what I'm talking about.
Come on now.
My God.
That sometimes you're silent when you should be speaking.
Yes, Lord.
Help us, Lord.
When you know it's not truthful. But see, the famine pushed him to Egypt for him to gain wealth, and he starts to get favor after the famine, and I begin to see how these economy interruptions are masked, depending on who looked at them. Who? Jesus! They're masked. Why? Because while one person is looking at it as a famine,
come on,
Abram is looking at it as favor.
Come
yeah.
on!
Yeah.
He's getting favor in the famine.
Yeah.
He's getting favor in the famine. And then I start to look at famines. And I start to see how Joseph got favor in the famine.
Mm-hmm.
And then I start to see how Elisha got favor in the famine. Then I start to see how Elijah got favor in the famine. Then I recognize that God brings economy interruptions, not because he's trying to kill us, but because he's trying to favor us. He's trying to give us favor in the place where the famine is suffering. And God is saying, this is how I separate those who have favor versus those who have famine. I said, God, how do you separate it? He said, because one person will be worried about their next meal, the other person will be praising me because they know that meal is on the way. I know who I'm talking to. every loss. I'm grateful for what I have gained.
Come on.
Yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Yes, God.
Favor. Favor in the famine. Favor in the famine indicates that God chooses me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Even when I don't see how to choose myself.
Amen.
Cool.
Amen.
When everything in me is dry,
yes, Lord.
He chose me.
Thank you, God.
When I still want to lie,
yes,
He chose me. Oh, God.
Yes.
When I'm trying to manipulate my way through, He chose me.
Yes.
That's what famine is. Famine is our dry place that's not growing. That means it wasn't just the land, Aaron, that wasn't growing.
It
was also Abram that wasn't growing. But God still chose me.
Ah.
I need to talk to somebody who knows sometimes that although you want to be spiritual and you want to tell everybody to grow, there comes a point in life when you don't feel like you're growing at all. You ain't reading your Bible. You ain't praying. You ain't worshiping. You ain't praying.
Come on, man.
You ain't singing. You ain't talking to Jesus. You ain't listening to nobody's counsel. You ain't doing nothing. God wants to do.
Praise God.
He still loves you. He still protects you. He still shields you. I just got a pause because I know I should have died in my family. God is saving me. I got a favor in me, bro. Anybody got a favor in me? My God. When I was in the famine,
yes, Lord.
He favored me.
Yes, he
when I wasn't growing,
yes,
oh,
yes,
he favored me.
Yes.
When I was immature,
yes.
He favored me.
Yes.
When I didn't know where to go,
yes.
He favored me. When I tried to manipulate my way through,
yes.
He favored me. When I tried to pick my own way, He favored me. When I forgot about His plan, He favored me. When I get off His path, yes. Somebody say He favored me.
He favored me. I thank you, Jesus.
He's giving them favor. He's giving them favor. He's giving them favor in this famine. And Abram at the time. Abram now has wealth. He now has sheep. And he gets it from an economy interruption. But not only he, but the Bible says in the next chapter 13 that Lot, his nephew, has some wealth.
Oh my gosh.
His pocket's that thick.
Yeah.
My God. He had some wealth and they couldn't stay in the same space, in the same territory together. Because both of them had wealth. And I have to pause for a moment because oftentimes we think everybody is supposed to be favored.
Mm.
Yeah.
But if everybody was favored, then favor wouldn't be favor.
That's right.
Come on. Come on, somebody. If everybody had favor would be common. It would cease to be favor.
Right.
It would cease to be supernatural. It would just be natural. But sometimes, God will put you in the position.
Yes, Lord.
For you to have a relationship with somebody who has favor.
Yeah.
And for you to be blessed by that favor.
Right.
And if you're too powerful, you'll miss your own prosperity.
Yeah.
Why? Because you want more power than you do want the person.
Ooh.
Oh God. See, this is for my humble people.
Yeah.
This is for my humble people who say, God, however you get me there, just get me there.
Yeah.
However you take me, just take me.
Yeah.
I'll go to where you send me. I'll send you who you take me to. And that's what you need me to do.
Yeah.
Why? Because I don't need to be Noah. I just need to be one of his sons.
From the master's table.
My God.
Hallelujah.
You miss your prosperity when you desire power more than the person.
Yeah.
Lot desired the power
So he forsook the person. Yeah. Watch it. The next economy interruption he had was that this economy was too small. Why? Because whenever somebody desires power in the same place where God has made somebody else to be powerful, it can't exist in the same place.
Right. Yeah, right.
Power.
Amen.
Watch this. Power legitimate will always conflict with power counterfeit.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Lord.
Power legitimate will always conflict with power counterfeit.
Yeah.
Always.
Yes. Yes.
Always. You never see a counterfeit 20 and a real 20 in the same place. They didn't exist to get a legal.
That's right.
And see, I used to work at a shoe store. Maybe y'all know what I'm talking about. So I used to work at a shoe store, and at the end of the day, I had to count up the money, and we had to go do a drop deposit. And when you drop it in a deposit, you put in the amount that you drop.
Yeah.
But the bank, when they come in the next morning, they actually count the money. And if they have any money that's counterfeit, they will tell you that they'll send you a slip and say, we have some X amount of money that was counterfeit that you put in. Therefore, your account is deducted by the amount that's counterfeit. Why? Because although it looked like it, and although it had the same representation, and although it tricked you, it still can be added to your account. See, I don't know who I'm talking to. But when God said, Abraham, I want to count this as righteousness, what he was really saying was, your power is legitimate. Your power is authentic. You have the right to be a righteous and standing with me. You're not a counterfeit.
I'm a counterfeit. Get on. Come on now.
Help us, God.
Help us, Lord.
Famine led to forsaking.
Mm.
See, in the famine, it caused him to go to Egypt, and it caused him to get wealth, but coming out of there, it caused Lot to become prideful. And Lot said, we can cause this. I'll let go of some of this. Lot said, no, I'm going to go over here where the pastures look green. And the Bible says it looks as green as Eden. He said, I'm going over here to Sodom and Gomorrah, like Egypt and Zoar. That's what it says in the Bible. He says, I'm going over here. You stay back here. I'm going over here. And he forsook. And I know from a man who's been forsaken, I know Abel.
Come on now.
How he could accept it.
Yes, Lord.
But the man I brought out of Ur, I could have let you die back in Babylon with the rest of the family. But I brought you with me. I fed you.
Yes, Lord.
I helped you. I gave to you.
Lord have mercy.
See, when it comes to interruptions in your life, sometimes it's not what happened, but who does it?
Mm.
Ooh.
Right.
Sometimes it's not the fact that you threw me in a pit, but it's that you're my brothers.
Right.
Sometimes it's not the fact that you doubted me that I could defeat Goliath, but it's because you're my brother who doubted me that I could defeat Goliath.
Yeah.
Sometimes it's not what happened, sometimes it's who did it.
That's right.
You
in there. Who did it hurts worse than actually what happened.
Yes, Lord.
I can deal with somebody else making me who I didn't feed. I can deal with one of these servants walking away from me, but you?
Yeah, that's right.
I fed you.
Yes, Lord.
I helped you.
Yes, Lord.
I took you in as my own.
Yes, Lord.
I didn't even have a son. You became my son. I treated you like you were mine. And you forsake me. And the Bible says that when he forsook him, watch this, Richard. The next chapter said, then the war happened.
Wow.
And it ended up capturing Lot. That's where we started.
Wow.
The next chapter says it went from the famine to being forsaken, now the fight.
Yeah. Wow.
And the fight, watch this. In the fight, Lot, although he had wealth, had no army.
Ha!
Lord
have mercy.
Mm-hmm.
He had no fight. Ha!
Right.
God! Jesus! He had no fight. See, I would rather, and maybe this is just me, I would rather struggle for my success than for somebody to hand it to me.
Yeah.
Oh God, y'all don't know what I'm talking about. I would rather fight for mine than for you to give it to me. Why? Because when somebody wants to take it, come on. Because somebody will always want to take it. Somebody will always want to take your joy. Somebody will always want to take your peace. Somebody will always want to take your serenity. We will say, me and my boo, we happy. Somebody will always come in and say, no, you ain't good. He's just a blind and a true fan. They will always want to take it. If you don't have enough to fight with, you will lose the thing that you have.
Yes, Lord.
Because the struggle wasn't earned by
success. That's right.
By success. The success that comes from struggle. And, then I had to start looking at what God was doing in these economic interruptions. Watch this, Aaron. He was showing Abram, one, whenever an interruption happened, I'm going to give you favor in the famine. But then, two, whenever somebody forsake you, you don't cry. Why? Because it's just me realigning your fellowship. Mm. Oh, God, can I help somebody with this? See, you was fellowshipping with Lot this whole time. But I need you to spend time with these men that's in your house.
Yes.
Why? Because there's something that's happening that you don't even see yet. And if you keep messing with Lot and worrying about all of his stuff, you don't have time to focus on training the men that you don't need with the fight of. Why? Because you're spending all of your time focusing on the person who is not going to be there in your future. And you all know what I'm talking about. See, sometimes God will send an interruption in your life to make the person that you're focused on to leave so that you can refocus on fellowship and the right person that's going to be there for your future. Somebody say, refocus on fellowship. That means you're going to change who is around you. You're going to change how you communicate with the people in your church. That means you got to stop thinking that frustration and fellowship is normal.
Yeah. Wow.
Mm.
Wow.
Lot and Abel have frustration and fellowship.
Yeah.
They ain't normal.
It's not.
They was going back and forth. That ain't normal.
No.
We do this all the time. I don't care. Yeah. It ain't normal.
Come on.
Can I teach it?
Yes,
it.
Come on here.
Why? Because there comes a point where I gotta know that when I get in the fight, you got my back.
Yes.
And if we've been spending this whole time fighting amongst each other, that I don't see that you're preparing for the future that's to come.
Yeah.
When the fight comes, I'm gonna be a little skeptical to jump in. Then I mean you don't have my back. It just means I don't know for sure that you got my back. Why? Because the whole time we've been fighting against each other. The whole time we've been frustrated against each other. The whole time it just means. And the truth of it is, I'm supposed to be training up people in my house. Why? Because there's gonna come a time where I'm gonna start calling some men to fight for something.
Yes, Lord.
And somebody has to take.
Come on, Lord.
God comes to him.
Yeah.
God comes to him and says, now after these things, now you see.
Amen.
Now after these things, I'll give you a word to say, watch this. I am your shield, your reward. God, why are you my shield now? I just got into a fight.
Right.
I need to talk to some people who's in a fight. Sometimes y'all don't feel like God just. Abram said, this doesn't add up.
Right.
I just got into a fight.
Mm-hmm.
Now you're saying you're my shield?
Yes, Lord.
I'm on here. I needed a shield back here.
Right.
I needed a shield.
Just a few verses.
Back here.
Yeah,
hey, God said, no, you didn't. No, you didn't. I'm your shield now. Why? Because anytime you're delivered from something,
yeah!
You always have to defend yourself right up.
Yeah!
Oh, God, then let me teach you this thing right here. See, anytime you leave a relationship because you grew out of it, you always got to defend why.
Yeah.
Oh, God, y'all ain't talking to me. Anytime you tell somebody you can't talk to them no more, you always got to defend yourself. Anytime you try to tell somebody that I've been delivered and God has delivered me, you got to give up. Why? Why you want to do it? And why you have to defend yourself? And God says, you don't need to defend when you're in a fight. Why? Because you're strong enough to walk out of it. You need to defend after the fight that you don't have to nobody. Oh, God. You don't have to nobody. Oh, God. Oh, why you gave up? Oh, why you left? Oh, why you didn't answer? Oh, why you hung up the phone? Oh, why you didn't text back? I don't have to ask you why, because God is my shield. God is my shield. If you got a problem, go talk to him. He's my shield. Watch this. And even though I got all this wealth, and you want to have it back, he's my exceedingly great reward. I don't know what I'm talking about. That even all the stuff that you got, it ain't even worth the stuff I'm gonna give you. Just know, you ain't gonna defend yourself no more. You ain't gonna fight for yourself no more. I got you on the backside of it.
Wow.
God just needs you to make it through the economy interruptions.
Yeah.
So that he can show you that he's not inconsistent.
Wow.
Sometimes we're more stressed about, watch this, not even the interruptions, but the inconvenience of the interruption.
Yeah.
It's an inconvenience that I got to go through this.
Yeah.
It's an inconvenience that I got to deal with my finances this way.
Yeah.
It's an inconvenience that I got to have this conversation. It's an inconvenience. And we're arguing about the threat of inconvenience, not understanding that the threat of inconvenience doesn't make God inconsistent.
Right.
He's still consistent.
Yes, he is.
He's still consistent.
Yes,
he is. We stress about the threat of trouble, Brother Richard, and not the truth of trouble.
Yeah.
Mm.
Think about it. We're always thinking about what may happen.
Right.
It threatens us, the threat of trouble.
Yeah.
But when trouble actually comes, your God has never left you nor forsaken you. When trouble actually stands up, your God has never forsaken you. When trouble actually comes your way, even though we've been made a deal for a night, don't you always say it? Don't you always say it? Don't you always say it in the morning? We're talking about the stress of trouble. And not the truth of trouble.
Come on.
Because the truth of the matter is, you ain't lost the fight yet, Abram.
Hallelujah.
The truth of the matter is, I send famines your way, and you got favor. The truth of the matter is, I send people to forsake you, and you really got your fellowship. The truth of the matter is, that I said, watch this, that I sent you a fight, and you found a friend. See, y'all missed it. And whenever I read to you, James, chapter number 2, it's because that in the same text that God just told him this, that's when Abraham stepped out from being just a servant to now being a friend of God. Not being a God in the face. Now I'm on his own watch because I believe him.
Yeah, thank you.
My God.
My God. Abraham believed God because he stopped seeing his life as being a challenge and stopped seeing it as being a chisel. Can I break this down for you? See, I was going through my own fights to stay in ministry for a long time.
Yes, Lord.
And the challenge of ministry and getting started when God has called you to do a ministry is incomparable to anything else. Because you are operating in the natural depending on the spiritual.
Mm-hmm.
Depending on the spiritual. And I say, God, I'm challenged. And I don't know if I'm going to make it through this challenge. And I remember one day praying, and God said, you're looking at the wrong thing.
Come on now.
You're looking at the famine and not the favor.
Wow.
You're looking at the forsaken and not the fellowship that you have now.
Yeah.
You're looking at the fight and not the friend. He says, you're looking at the wrong thing. You're looking at the fact that you're being challenged,
yes,
and you're not looking at the fact that you're being chiseled.
Wow.
And I said, God, what do you mean?
Yeah.
He says, see, what you got to understand is that you are a key to somebody's problem.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
You are a key to somebody's problem. You are an answer to somebody's problem.
Yeah.
You are being cut the right way for a rock you ain't seen yet.
Yeah.
You are being cut for something that you... He said, don't you know what I mean when I said, whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven.
Yeah.
Or you bind on earth. So that means whatever you lock up shall be locked up in heaven. Whatever you unlock shall be unlocked in heaven. See, what he's saying is, what I'm doing is making you into a key.
Yeah.
And you're looking at your challenges as something that's taken from you. He says, I'm just chiseling you. Why? Because I already got rocks out there for you.
Yeah.
And it won't work unless you go through the chiseling. I don't know who I'm talking to.
Yeah.
But you don't want to quit in the challenge. Why? Because the challenge is nothing more than a chisel.
Yeah.
Somebody say, I'm being chiseled. Somebody say, I'm being chiseled.
I'm being chiseled.
I am the key to somebody's life.
My God.
That's what makes you wealthy.
Yes.
That's what makes you prosperous.
Yes.
That's what makes you want to be needed.
Yes.
Is that you become the answer to somebody else's problem.
Thank you, God.
But you can never be the answer unless you go through the chisel.
Yes, Lord.
When
it
presents to you looking like challenges this morning, early. Somebody say early.
Early.
Early this morning.
Early.
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 I had to get up.
My God.
Me and my family. Because my son had a baseball game at 8 o'clock in the morning.
Yes,
y'all don't hear what I'm saying.
8 a.m.
8 o'clock in the morning.
An hour away.
At 8 o'clock.
Up at 5.
In the morning. And we had to drive 45 minutes to the game.
Yes,
he had to be there about 7:15.
No,
so we had to leave the house about 6:15.
Oh, no.
Oh, God. Y'all didn't hear what I'm saying.
I hear you.
So I said early in the morning.
Early in the morning.
Yeah.
Still dark. And we go to the game. And his team is playing. And it gets to the last inning of the game.
Yeah.
And we're out there, and I got to preach, so I'm meditating and watching and screaming and meditating and watching and screaming. I'm doing my dad thing. And it's 4-1. They're losing.
That happened.
They're in the last inning. In the last inning.
Mm-hmm.
And lo and behold, his team gets one out. Two outs, game over, season over. Next boy hit the ball, next boy hit the ball. Next boy hit the ball. One of his teammates scored. Scores 4-2. Next boy get out. Two outs, 4-2. Two people on base. Next boy get walked. Bases loaded. 4-2. Listen to me.
Yes,
two people on base. Next boy gets up. I'm ready to go. I got to preach. It's early already. I got to preach.
Yeah.
I got to get up out of here. Next boy hit the ball. The boy who throws the ball stumbles. Throws it to first. Mm-hmm. The first baseman has to come off the bag to catch it. The boy running down the first baseman looks like a linebacker.
Come on.
He's about 6'2", weighing about 220.
A full beard.
The boy comes off the base. Boom! Collision.
That happened.
Boy drops the ball. Two teammates score. They end up scoring four more runs. The next time they go into the field, because the other team has to bet, my son is in the field, playing third base. They scream over there because they want to rally. They hit a line drive. My son catches the ball.
Period.
I lose it.
Yeah.
I go crazy.
Yeah.
Next bat, they hit a bouncer to the gap. My son looks like he in the MLB. I don't know where he got it from. He catches the ball in the gap on the run
that
and
happened.
Makes a throw and
right.
Throws the boy out.
That happened.
The next boy,
yeah.
They struck out and they won the game.
8-4. Yeah.
And I am losing it.
Amen.
I'm losing it. And I begin to just ponder.
Yeah.
How much these boys actually felt when they thought the game
come on.
Was on.
Right.
And then I said, Abraham is 85 years old.
Yes.
Abraham has no children.
Yes.
Abraham says to God, this ain't what it looks like.
Yes.
Someday that look.
Yes. Right.
And God said, go out and start telling.
Yeah.
He says, can you tell me? He says, no, I can't tell. He says, why? Because that means I don't care how old you are.
Right.
I don't care how much you fought through.
Yeah.
I don't care how much it took for you to get here.
Yeah.
All I need you to understand that the game is not all over the world. I need somebody to understand that all I'm waiting for the family, the game ain't over. All I'm waiting for the game, the game ain't over. All I'm waiting for the game, the game ain't over. The game ain't over. The game ain't over. Get on, take the game, no question. You are the game in your generation. You are game changer. Why? Because you didn't quit. Because you didn't quit. Your generation will be blessed. Go outside. Start on the start. Why? Because your generation will be stars that come from your heart. You didn't quit. You will change the game. You will change the game with your family. You will change the game with your house. We don't deal with the game with your generation.
Yeah.
You desire to stay in the fight.
My.
Your desire to walk through the famine.
Yeah.
Your desire to deal with people who forsaken you.
My God.
Will cause you to change the game.
Yes.
Because it ain't over yet.
Yeah.
Don't tell me you're over 40. It ain't over yet.
Right.
Don't tell me you're more than 50. It ain't over yet.
It ain't.
Don't
it
tell
ain't.
Me you're over 60. It ain't over yet.
Right.
It ain't over. It ain't over.
Yes.
You are now coming out of the place where you feel a famine, where you feel forsaken, where you feel like you're fighting, to now you're becoming a friend.
Yeah.
I need somebody to walk in that friend of mine. I'm a friend of God. I'm a friend of God. I'm not a violent one of these easy friends that just come around when they need some God. He sticks closer than a brother. I'm a friend of God. He calls me friend. He calls me the mystery that he didn't give to his family. I'm a friend. He taught me friend.
Thank you, God.
He taught me friend. The reason he taught you friend is because he said you're going to change the game.
Yes, Lord.
Now do me a favor. If you can't count the stars, don't count out your God.
Yes, Lord.
If you can't count the dust of the earth, don't count out your God.
That's right.
Even though it don't add up.
That's right.
The game ain't over yet.
That's
if you
right.
Believe that word, give him a praise right now.
Yeah.
If you believe that word, Give him a great round of applause. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. If you believe him right now, if you believe him right now, he will credit it to your account.
Yes, he will.
As righteousness. Yes, I'm so glad my God is a CPA.
Yes, he will.
I'm so glad my God is an accountant.
Yes.
And that he doesn't use the same thing that I use to account my account.
Yes.
But he says, if I believe in him, my account is in peace.
Yes,
he says, if I believe in him, my account just went up.
Yes.
He said, if I believe in him, I just got more leverage to use my account. I need somebody who believes in God. I just give him one more praise. I believe you. I believe you.
Thank you, God.
When you don't add up,
yes.
I believe in you.
Yes, Lord. Yes.
Father God, we thank you this morning for your word.
Thank you.
We thank you for your truth. Now, as we leave this place, I pray we never leave your presence.
Yes, Lord.
For you are the one true and living King. We love you and we thank you.
Thank you.
In Jesus' name, amen. Give him a praise.
Yes.
Give him